Parallel again between the seventh-day Sabbath and the sanctuary. So seven seemed to be very important.
grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious is the grace of Him, the hour I first believe. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace, unending love, amazing grace, unending love, amazing
Jesus is coming in a manger. Oh, Lord is coming. Yahweh, Jesus is coming, born in Bethlehem. Born in Bethlehem. Yahweh, Jesus is teaching in a temple. Oh, Lord is teaching. Yahweh, Jesus is teaching. No one speaks like Him. No one speaks like Him. Hosanna, He comes in the form of a man, Jehovah the Great, God of Abraham. He lives just to die for our sins, Yahweh, for we sing. Yahweh, Jesus is praying in the garden. Oh, Lord is praying. Jesus is praying,
let this pass from me,
let this pass from me. Yahweh, Jesus is dying
on the cross there. Oh, Lord is dying.
Yahweh, Jesus is dying,
dying
Jesus is rising, oh Lord is rising. From the grave there, oh Lord is rising. Yahweh, Jesus is rising, now he lives again. Yes, he lives again. Hosanna, he comes in the form of a man. Jehovah the great, God of Abraham. He lives just to die for our sins. He rose from the grave. He lives again. He rose from the grave. He lives again. He rose. He arose. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
There's a place for every worker in the vineyard of the Lord, where with all our powers united, we can toil with one accord. There are needy hearts now waiting for the help which we can give. Let us guide them safely onward, let us show them how to live. There's a place, oh may I find it, where my mission I can fill. Be it humble or exalted, may I hold it with a will. Help to serve my generation with a heart of love and grace. Help me, Lord, from this time onward, find and occupy my place. There's a place for every teacher in the Bible training school, where our natures are made sweeter as we teach the golden rule. There are called for royal service, where we all lay work and pray. Let us then be up and doing, teaching men the Savior's way. There's a place, oh may I find it, where my mission I can fill. Be it humble or exalted, may I hold it with a will. Help to serve my generation with a heart of love and grace. Help me, Lord, from this time onward, find and occupy my place. There's a place for every Christian in the church which we should serve, where we may uphold her standards and from duty never swerve. There are burdens to be lifted, there are hearts in pain and grief. Let us help the heavy laden, bringing comfort and relief. Oh, there's a place, so may I find it, where my mission I can fill. Be it humble or exalted, may I hold it with a will. Help to serve my generation with a heart of love and grace. Help me, Lord, from this time onward, find and occupy my place.
Wow, wow, wow. Can you believe this?
Wow.
It's here again. Folks, it's here again. Kamara, can you believe this?
Yes.
It's actually here again.
Yes, wow. Alan, it is here again. And we are excited about ASI Jamaica Week 2021, a virtual celebration.
Did you say virtual celebration, Kamara?
I did.
Oh, my goodness.
Made no mistakes. So, virtual celebration.
So that means all conference social media platforms.
All conference social media
break
platforms.
Break it down for us,
Kamara. So we have Facebook. We have YouTube.
Wow.
We have WCCN.
Wow.
Blessed are those
who watch.
Blessed TV. We have all those platforms. And on top of that, Alan, we have NCU Radio.
Right.
We have NCU TV. So we'll be here, there, and everywhere. In fact, this is Jamaica Union's ASI event.
Yes.
So it promises to be good.
But watch this now. We have a theme. A beautiful theme. It is break out of your walls. Am I right?
That's it.
Mercy. And say no.
I will go.
Oh,
that's
my
it.
Goodness.
That's it. That's it. That's it. That's it.
Folks, you have to log on. It's hot in here, but it's going to be sweet on your side.
That's correct.
Mercy.
Now, let us remind our viewers of the times that they can log on to this event each night.
Yes,
so what time will we be starting?
Well, Jamaica time, 7 p.m. sharp.
Which nights, Alan?
Sunday, tonight.
Yes.
Tomorrow.
Yes.
Which is Monday. Tuesday.
Yes.
Wednesday.
Yes.
Draw your brakes on Thursday. It's going to be rest night.
Yes.
But then we pick it up back on Friday night.
And on Sabbath, we begin at 9 a.m. So welcome to the opening ceremony. Tonight's program will be led out by which conference?
Wow, the North Jamaica Conference.
That's right.
Hey, may I give a shout out to my dear president, Pastor Carl Archer.
That's right.
Hello, my friend.
Mm-hmm, of course. And so, we have various activities lined up for you tonight.
Mercy,
so we are sure that you, as a lay worker, as a business owner, whether small or large, you are going to have a treat at our ASI launch tonight.
That's right.
Alan, we need to tell the people some more information.
Talk to me.
So for this week, we have three vibrant speakers lined up.
Did
Who
you hear
is
that?
Coming on
wait,
tonight?
Did you hear that? Repeat that. Repeat that.
Three vibrant speakers.
Wow.
Lined up tonight. So let's break it down.
Wow.
Let's break it down.
Wow.
Let's break it down.
Talk to me.
So tonight, we have gotta check my notes.
One and only.
Deputy Chief of Chaplains of the United States Army. Who's that?
I like Dr. Andrew Harewood.
That's right.
You see, when I call you, said doctor. Yeah. Dr. Andrew Harewood is
He's on tonight.
Yes.
And on Wednesday night.
Wow.
Who's on Wednesday night?
Well, you know, I can feel it so close home. It's none other than our one and only, the President, Glenn O. You know, you have a way to say it, you know. But he's none other than Glenn O. Samuels. He's the President of the West Jamaica Conference here in Jamaica. Oh, I love to hear when he speaks.
Now, Alan, this is the moment.
It's bubbling.
For Sabbath. We have a speaker.
Yeah.
What would he normally say?
Wow. Listen to this.
Yes.
It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood.
Can you tell us who that is?
Oh, my goodness. I love him. I can't wait. Ladies and gentlemen, we're talking about the 62nd U.S. Senate chaplain, none other than Dr. Barry
Black.
It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood. It's going to be a beautiful day this Sabbath.
That's right.
You can't afford to miss it, ladies and gentlemen. You can't afford to miss this.
Not at all.
Wow.
So you have been noticing so far that you are lined up for a treat and you cannot afford to miss it. Therefore, we're going to ask you to share that link that others in our church and otherwise can know what's happening here. And Alan, we want to also make some special greetings at this juncture.
Okay.
So our union, Jamaica Union ASI President.
That's right.
Jamaica Union ASI President. Mm-hmm. Who's that?
Well, Elder, is it Elder Cecil Foster?
Elder Cecil Foster, we greet you well, sir. And how about the Inter-American Division ASI President?
Yes.
Who was that?
All right, care to tell us?
Dr. Marston Thomas, of course.
Hello, Doc.
And we take it home to our vibrant, ASI President for the West Jamaica Conference.
Let me introduce
him. Go ahead.
I'm going to speak this into being, my friend. You're none other than Dr. Elder Wayne Clark. I'm speaking it into being,
right. Futuristic language here.
Yes.
That's right. Elder Wayne Clark.
That's
the
right.
The ASI President for the West Jamaica Conference Chapter. And brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, small business owners, medium business owners, we are in for a treat.
Amen.
And we want you to remember to share that link to others so that they can learn about the ASI events.
That's right.
Be encouraged. And not only be encouraged, Alan, we want to build a network.
Wow.
ASI is all about building network and not only that, but taking Jesus into the marketplace.
That's it.
Taking Jesus into our work, into how we tell others that, look, Jesus is coming again.
That's right.
That's
and it's all
aim.
About our global
the
platform.
Matthew 28 Commission.
Well, let us pray as we talk about Matthew 28 Commission. Join us in prayer.
I invite you to bow your heads wherever you are at this time for the opening prayer. Let us pray. Almighty Father in heaven, we praise and we adore your matchless name. We thank you, O Lord, for the opportunity to come together in this fashion. You have provided the technology for us to bridge the gap between the miles that separate us and to worship in one place, whereas your name is being broadcast in diverse places. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to share with people across Jamaica and across the world in this or ASI week. And so we ask a rich and overflowing blessing on this program. We ask, O Lord, that you will bless each speaker, each singer, each presenter, everyone that will have something to do with this program. And even those, Lord, working behind the scenes, we pray that your hand of anointing will be upon them. We pray for those who will hear the various messages that will be broadcast throughout the course of this week, that their hearts will be blessed, that their lives will be transformed, and that they'll be drawn closer to you in a saving relationship. We thank you, Lord, for all that you have done and all that you are doing, and we look forward to the glorious appearing of your soon return. May this hope burn in our hearts. And may it spur us on to do even greater things for you as we proclaim the great day of your appearing. These mercies we ask, and for this we give you thanks. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen.
Music plays an important part in our worship. So at this time, we will have special music to be done by Sister Noveline Espute. Please listen and be blessed.
Jesus knew that man will surely fall, but I'm glad the Savior precious blood covered it all. See, I try to imagine just how this miracle took place. Such love beyond all measure, it's our God, amazing grace. See, sometimes we might definitely, we might stumble and fall, but just one drop of my Savior precious blood covered it all. The blood, the blood covers it all. Love has no boundaries, since death paid it full. Jesus knew in the beginning that man will surely fall, but I'm glad the Savior precious blood covered it all. The blood, the blood instead paid it full. Jesus knew in the beginning that man will surely fall, but I'm glad the Savior precious blood covered it all. See, I try to imagine just how this miracle took place. Such love beyond all measure, it's our God's amazing grace. Oh, sometimes we might definitely, Lord, we might stumble and fall, but just one drop of my Savior precious blood covered it all. The blood covers it all. Love has no boundaries, since dead pain knew in the beginning that man will surely fall, but I'm glad the Savior precious blood covered it all. But I'm glad the Savior precious blood, see it covers it all. Amen. Amen.
It is my extreme pleasure to welcome you all to this Jamaica Union ASI Week of Activities 2021. We celebrate this year under the theme, Break Out of Your Walls, where the weak is helped by the strong, and the weak become strong, and the strong stronger. We are looking forward to a wonderful week of celebrations. Last year, our first ASI virtual convention was one that we enjoyed so much, and we had it over 3 days. This year, we are having it for the entire week, from tonight, the 13th of June, until Sabbath, which will be the 19th of June. We are welcoming you. We are inviting you to join us every night at 7 p.m. We are asking you to invite your friends. We are asking you to invite your families. We are asking you to just invite God in your hearts every single night. And as you come, just prepare to be blessed. We at the Jamaica Union ASI are very, very pleased to present to you the activities of the week. And as we go through the week and God bless you, you just share that blessing with others who you come in contact with. So we look forward to having you, and we pray that as the nights rolls by, we all will get a little closer together, even though we are virtual. So 2021 ASI Week of Celebrations begins tonight, and you are welcomed. And we pray that you'll have a wonderful night and all nights following after this. Thank you, and may God bless you.
Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, it is my greatest pleasure and privilege to present to you at this time the president of the Jamaica Union Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, Pastor Everett Brown.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is a joy for me to be identified with ASI Jamaica and to have the privilege of participating in this virtual celebration. First, I'd like to commend the leadership of ASI Jamaica, led by Elder Cecil Foster and the team of ASI leaders and members across Jamaica, with the support of the union sponsor, Dr. Joseph Smith. Your theme speaks eloquently of your focus: break out of your walls. This virtual program is being conducted amidst the worldwide pandemic. But I sense that your desire as ASI members to share Christ in the marketplace has influenced you to use technology to do that which God has called you to do. And so I wish to congratulate you and greet you on behalf of the officers and workers, indeed the wider membership of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Jamaica. We trust that as you partner with business leaders to leverage their expertise to enhance and improve your business operations, as you seek to connect with the wider community to not only improve business practices, to not only improve your membership business operations, but as you touch the lives of people in the wider community, many hearts will be converted to Jesus Christ. And so I wish for you, as I greet you, a most successful week of celebration. God bless you, and accept our greetings.
I'm here to share with you the activities for the week that we are celebrating starting tonight. The activities for Sunday night. As you know, the presenter will be Dr. Andrew Harewood, and he is the Deputy Chaplain of the United States Army. And we are expecting a wonderful sermon from Dr. Harewood. He is a friend of Jamaica, a friend of Jamaicans, and he has spent many, many times here in Jamaica working with the ASI and with Alfred Thomas and the Advent Fellowship Youth in Kingston. And so we look forward to Sunday night. On Monday night, we are going to be having a panel discussion with some of the leaders of businesses in Jamaica. We have Breakout to share how to move your business beyond COVID. That's a part of what we will be discussing, and that discussion will be led by our own brother, Alvin Wint, that will be leading that. And we're gonna have people from Proven, have people from Jamaica Manufacturing Association, and we are looking forward to a wonderful time. So we ask you to invite your friends and invite all your neighbors to join us as we discuss how we can get through this COVID-19 as businesses. We want you to know how you can break out of your walls and develop strategies that can help you to get your business remain strong or becoming strong through this COVID-19 and beyond. On Wednesday night, of course, we know we have our own indomitable Footprints of Hope presenter and the president of the West Jamaica Conference, Pastor Glenn O. Samuels. And I think this place will be blown up on Wednesday night, and so we can't miss Wednesday night. Thursday night, we are asking you to join the ASI missionaries who will tell how they are breaking out of their walls and sharing Christ in the marketplace. But on Thursday night, we'll have two things. We will be having a private discussion. We call it a think tank discussion as ASI executives with the leaders or the decision makers of the Adventist Church in Jamaica. So from that discussion, we are hoping to develop a framework, a partnership that the laypersons and the leadership of the church can work together to finish the work that God has given us to do in this vineyard. Friday night, break out in praise. This is where every single chapter in Jamaica will have representatives on the musical program of praise and just musical feast. So Friday night at 7 o'clock, you can't miss it. On Sabbath, the 19th, the grand finale, Dr. Barry Black, the 62nd chaplain of the United States Senate, he will be here live and in living color to share a wonderful message with us. A break out of your walls. We can't afford to miss it. We are asking all our members and our friends and our neighbors and whoever you see and know out there to join us in this week of celebrations. But the Sabbath is not gonna be over until we speak to members who are business owners from across Jamaica who have used their businesses to support the mission of the church. We will be talking to them and hearing from them and see the challenges that they have faced and are facing and how we can move forward in this COVID period. That event in the afternoon of the Sabbath will be chaired or moderated by our good Coke, Nigel Coke from the Jamaica Union. And so we are looking forward to a wonderful day. We ask you again and again to join us, and we are saying to you, let us come together and break out of our walls, because only if we break out of our walls, we can get to accomplish what God has called us to accomplish. May God bless you, and we look forward to a great week. Thank you so much.
ASI President Jamaica, Elder Cecil Foster, Pastor Everett Brown, President of Jamaica Union Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, Pastor Glenn O. Samuels, President of West Jamaica Conference, ASI Chapter Presidents, Pastors, fellow ASI members, greetings. I am delighted to salute you on this, the first day of your grand ASI week. About 10 years ago, the Executive Committee of the Inter-American Division of Seventh-day Adventists gave the nod to ASIers in the division to have an ASI day every third Sabbath in June. And since then, this has been practiced all over the division. Jamaica Union ASIers have taken this mandate just a little further, celebrating one entire week. And we at the division are excited and happy as you continue to share Christ in the marketplace in this way. In a week, you have more time to plan strategies to enhance the church's theme, I Will Go, and to enact programs to help to motivate the businessmen and women, professionals, and other members of the church to do greater things for God. We note that you have geared this week towards our businessmen and women and the professionals, as you will be putting on a special forum to deal with the issues that are affecting us during these challenging times. I invite you, as you share this week, and all of our friends who are listening and watching all over Inter-American Division, that other ASI chapters will be motivated to come on board. I must encourage you and tell you that the French and the Spanish and Dutch eras are all planning conventions to celebrate this year. IAD wants to commend you and to wish you a spirit-filled week. With the powers vested in me as president of the Inter-American Division of ASIRs, I declare this week open and wish for you a great success and a very happy week. May God bless you.
The scripture reading comes to us from Acts chapter 12, and I'll be reading verse 6 through to 10. I'll also be reading from the Good News Translation. The night before Herod was going to bring him out to the people, Peter was sleeping between two guards. He was tied with two chains, and there were guards on duty at the prison gate. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord stood there, and a light shone in the cell. The angel shook Peter by the shoulder, woke him up, and said, "Hurry, get up!" At once the chain fell off Peter's hands. Then the angel said, "Tighten your belt and put on your sandals." Peter did so, and the angel said, "Put your cloak around you and come with me." Peter followed him out of the prison, not knowing, however, if what the angel was doing was real. He thought he was seeing a vision. 10 and last, they passed by the first guard station and then the second, and came at last to the gate that opens into the city. The gate opened for them by itself, and they went out. They walked down the street, and suddenly the angel left Peter. Here ends a portion of God's holy words.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. It is my pleasure to introduce our speaker to commence this special ASI Week celebration here in Jamaica. Our speaker is none other than Brigadier General Andrew R. Harewood, Deputy Chief of Chaplains for the Army Reserve and the Director of Strategy, Plans, Policy and Resource for the Office of the Chief of Chaplains at the Pentagon. Brigadier General Harewood first entered military service as an enlisted soldier in 1990. Following 5 years of service, he completed both master's and doctoral degrees at Howard University in Washington, and was the Howard University 1995 recipient of the Henry G. Maynard Scholastic Award. Prior to his commission, he served with the 92nd Field Hospital and the 5th Battalion, the 159th Aviation Regiment. Brigadier General Harewood became the Deputy Chief of Chaplains in the United States Army Reserve on the 1st of November, 2020. He serves as the primary Army Reserve Liaison in the United States Army Chief of Chaplains and the Chaplain Corps Chief Strategist. He is an ordained minister and is endorsed by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Brigadier General Harewood, his military awards and decorations are numerous. They include the Defense Meritorious Service Medal, the Army Meritorious Service Medal, the Army Commendation Medal, the NATO Medal, the Military Outstanding Volunteer Service Medal, the Martin of Tours Award and citation from the White House, the Pennsylvania Senate, and various other civic and denominational awards. Brigadier General Harewood is married to Karen Annett, a physician, and they have 4 sons, Andrew, Jason, Aaron, and Jalon. His hobbies include reading, distance running, billiards, scuba diving, and devising creative and educational methods of comprehensive leadership. His motto is, "Don't tell me, show me." Ladies and gentlemen, I am pleased to present this man of God. I am confident that the Holy Spirit will use him mightily to set the right tone for a wonderful week of ASI activities. May God bless us as we listen to the servant of God. Thank you.
Whoa. Good evening. And thank you for Indeed. This coveted opportunity to be with you once again.
We can surely say
and to my colleagues who
that
will share
God
later this
as
week,
our captain,
Chaplain Black and Samuels, know that you are in my thoughts, you are in my prayers, and I'm deeply honored to be serving on the same platform with you this weekend. Giving honor and glory to God, who is the head of my life, to the President, Bishop Thomas, to the Global Ambassador, Madam Yvonne Lawson, to all the other officers of the regional ASI community, I say thank you. And finally, of course, to all my brothers and sisters across the globe watching and waiting for a word, I solicit your prayers. Let's get started. You have appropriately chosen as a theme for this moment, break out of your walls. And the Lord has led me to a text with a breakout story. So if you would permit me to read in your hearing a very familiar text found in the book of Acts, the 12th chapter, and lifting up verse 7, it says, "And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and he light shined in the prison. And he smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, Rise up quickly. And his chains fell off from his hands." Your theme is break out of your walls. And the Holy Spirit has arrested me to focus on the topic, leading after a breakout. Leading after a breakout. I want to do three things this evening, and then I'll take my seat. I want to paint a particular but practical picture. I want to pinpoint the prevailing problem and then prescribe God's peculiar prescription. My message in capsule is simply this: the devil's plots usually provides the preamble for God's platform, God's plan, and God's purpose. If I was in church, I'd say, can I get an amen? But please pray with me as we look at this topic, leading after a breakout. And now, my Father and my God, we come across the world in different locations, but we come as one family. And we ask now, God, as we begin this week of emphasis, this week of looking at what it means to be a part of an initiative to impact people's lives, we ask, oh God, that everything that will be done this week will be done to your name, to your honor, and to your glory. And even now, as I spend a few moments with my family and my friends, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be sufficient in your sight, my Lord and my Redeemer. Amen. The novel coronavirus, aka COVID-19, challenged the world. And the fact is, people, businesses, educational institutions, and even houses of worship will never be the same again. I don't usually quote Lenin, but he accurately once said, "There are decades when nothing happens, and weeks when decades happen." This is one of those times when history pressed on the gas, if you will. CNN host and best-selling author Fareed Zakaria, amongst others, helped readers and critical thinkers to understand the nature of a post-pandemic world. In his new book, his narrative gives focus to the political, social, technological, economic, and I would add spiritual, consequences that may take years to unfold. Written in the form of 10 lessons, covering topics from natural and biological risk to the rise of digital life to an emerging bipolar world order. I wish I had time to unpack that. But Zakaria helps readers and thinkers to begin thinking beyond the immediate effects of COVID-19 with his 10 lessons for a post-pandemic world. In outline form, he says, buckle up, lesson one. We may be in for something similar but worse down the road. Lesson two, what matters is not the quantity of leadership, but the quality. Lesson three, markets are not enough. People should listen to the experts, and experts should listen to people. Lesson four. Lesson five, life is digital. The digital world is here to stay. Lesson six, Aristotle was right. We are social animals. Lesson seven, inequalities will get worse. Globalization is not dead. Lesson eight. Lesson nine, the world is becoming bipolar, and I really wish I had time to unpack that one with you this evening. And then finally, lesson 10, sometimes the greatest realities are the idealists. In a 2016 box office star-studded movie entitled Collateral Beauty, starring the likes of Will Smith, Naomi Harris, Keira Knightley, Kate Winslet, Helen Mirren, and on, it depicts a successful New York advertising executive, who was played by Will Smith, who suffered a great tragedy, and he retreats from life and everything else. And while his concerned friends try desperately to reconnect with him, he seeks answers from the universe by writing letters to love, time, and death. When his notes bring unexpected personal responses, and perhaps some of you may have seen it, but if you haven't, awesome, awesome movie. He begins to understand how these constraints interlocks in a life fully lived, and how even the deepest loss can reveal moments of meaning and beauty. COVID-19 has forced us to view the amplified lines of love, time, and death through a different lens, but yet sees the painful paradox of the collateral beauty in this painful global community moment. Try, if you will, Googling the economic loss of COVID-19. You won't find it, my friends. It's not there because the comprehensive loss of the past 18 months cannot be measured, and I suspect will not be for a long, long time. Break out of your walls. And so, how can you manage or even measure the worth of lost time and precious experiences? How can you measure the value of a loved one gone not just too soon, but you've never even had a chance to say your goodbyes? How can you begin to quantify and measure that deep, dark abyss of an empty hole inside when the worth of love is invaded with the bitter, empty void, and you struggle to exist as opposed to abundantly live your life? How? How can you live in the context of all of this stuff? And so, leading after a breakout becomes a very unique challenge, not just for you who are leaders in the community, your corporations, but even those of you who are leading in houses of worship. How do you lead? How do you live? How do you learn? What lessons do you garner from this as you move forward after this particular situation? The fact is, brothers and sisters, as a nation built on the premise, in God we trust. We've been walled up long before COVID-19. Chains was on us before the barricades of our very homes. Think about it. It was as if God permitted the Herod of isolation through a microscopic modicum of a virus that you can't even see with your naked eyes to imprison us and bring us to our knees that we are not in charge. But in fact, there's a greater force. And so as we break out of our walls to begin to do new things, I'm excited about the possibilities. The harsh reality is the church was in a pandemic mode long before March of 2019. Young adults and young professionals have been polite with their presence in our pews, but the truth be told, intellectually, they have been feeling like there is a pandemic of relevance. There's a pandemic of meaning that was coming from some of our pulpits. Long before March of 2019. But it's time to break out of our walls. And to be clear, there are several different kinds of types of walls. Several different types of walls. To name a few, they are the walls of self-hate. They're the walls of criticism. There's the walls of systematic injustice. The walls of homophobia. The walls of ministry stagnation. The walls of apathy. The walls of the isms, the legalism, racism, sexism, ageism, stupidity, and just downright craziness, to name a few. And to make no mistake about it, a wall does the same destructive work as a physical prison cell or being in iron chains, as we will see in our text. Robert Nesta Marley had a line in his infamous redemption song where he says, "Emancipate yourself from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds." You see, throughout the history of the world and the existence of man, the devil has always been trying to imprison the church. But when the early church was in prison, God used it to create a platform and a plan for a purpose. Sometimes we forget and sometimes we confuse having a plan with purpose. You can have a plan, but no purpose. And I've discovered that where you find your passion is when you have found your purpose. So don't confuse having a plan with a purpose. No, no, no. You've got to have a plan, but you've got to have some purpose. And in that purpose, I believe, will also come your passion. And so the text gives us some very interesting insight. Paint the picture. We want to paint the picture. And I'm going to read from the Amplified Version of the Bible. Now at that time, Herod Agrippa, the king of the Jews, arrested some who belonged to the church, intended to harm them. And he had James, the brother of John, put to death with a sword. And when he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to have Peter arrested as well. This was during the days of the unleavened bread, or the Passover week. When he had seized Peter, he put him in prison, turning him over to four squads of soldiers, of four each to guards within him. So get the picture. You have four squads of soldiers, four squads of guards guarding one person. And they were doing this in rotation throughout the night, planning after the Passover to bring him out to the people for execution. So his plan was to guard Peter. You know the story. To guard Peter, and he was being guarded heavily. And the plan was to bring him out to execute him. But the Bible says, so Peter was kept in prison, but, Lord have mercy, fervent and persistent prayer for him was being made to God by the church. So understand the picture now. He is guarded heavily in prison by 16 guards in four different quadrants. But while he's being guarded, God knew what Herod's plan was. You remember, whenever the devil tries to plan something, it becomes the preamble for the platform for God to move on his purpose and his plan. And verse 6 says, the very night before Herod was to bring him forward, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers. I'm painting the picture for you. Bound with two chains. The guards were in front of the door guarding the prison. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared beside him, and a light shone in the cell. The angel struck Peter aside and awoken him, saying, get up quickly. And the chains fell off his hands. I love that part. Just think about this for a moment, that the angel did not give Peter a key to unlock the chains. He just simply said, get up. And the Bible says, the chains fell off his hands. The angel said to him, prepare yourself and strap up your sandals to get ready for whatever may happen. And he did so. Then the angel told him, put on your robes and follow me. And Peter went out following the angel. He did not realize, watch this, he did not realize that what was being done by the angel was real. He still thought that he was sleeping. But though he was seeing it in vision. Verse 10, when they had passed the first guard and the second, they came to the iron gate that leads into the city. Of his own accord, I love this story, break out of your walls. Of his own accord, it, meaning the gate, swung open from them. And they went out and went along one street. And at once, the angel left him. So as soon as Peter gets out, the Bible says that the angel leaves him. But all along, as you read the story, and it's the kind of story we're not going to be able to unpack it all tonight. But as you read the story in pathos, you begin to see some points that will make you shout in the midst of just reading the story. Verse 11 says, when Peter came to his senses, in other words, he began to realize, I am not sleeping anymore. I'm not even in vision. But the Bible says, when Peter came to his senses, he says, now I know for certain that the Lord has sent his angel and has rescued me from the hands of Herod and from all that the Jewish people were expecting. When he realized what had happened, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, who also called John Mark, where many believers were gathered together and they were praying continually and had been praying all night. When he knocked on the door of the gateway, a servant girl named Rhoda, you know the story, came to answer. Recognizing Peter's voice in her joy, she filed to the gate, but ran in and announced that Peter was standing in front of the gateway. They said to her, you're out of your mind. But she kept insisting that it was Peter. So she kept saying, it is an angel, it's an angel. But meanwhile, verse 16, Peter continued knocking. And they opened the door and saw that it was him. They were completely amazed. But motioning to them with his hand to be silent, and to listen, he declared and described to them how he was led out of prison. And really, if I had time to really take that in a different direction, but that's not the focus for this evening, because I want to get to the lessons. I suspect one of my colleagues during the week will deal with some of the celebratory pieces, but I want to set the tone for you to understand what's going to happen this week. And I want to engage it from the lens of leading after a breakout. James and his brother, the sisters. Then he left and he went to another place. Verse 18 says, now, when the day came, because all this is taking place at night, there was no small disturbance. In other words, there was a whole lot of commotion. And the soldiers came over to ask what happened. When Herod had searched for him and could not find him, he interrogated the guards and commanded that they be led away to execution. So he killed the guards. I want you to underline that, because we can come back to that. Then he went down to Judea and he spent some time there. And if you keep reading the story, you discover that Herod, he becomes so arrogant that he goes and he sits down and he begins to give himself a lot of self-aggrandizement. But the Bible says in verse 24 that when he began to do that stuff, something bad happened. Early up in 21, you discover that when he started to give himself, that everything was about him, the Bible says that an angel came out. And of course, you know the story. Basically, you know, he was struck down because he was taking glory that should have gone to God. And so by way of quick footnotes, for those who are taking notes, Herod Agrippa was the grandson of Herod the Great, leading after a breakout. Since he was the descendant of this individual, it begins to make sense how he was reasoning. According to Colossians 4:10, Mary, that we find in Acts 12:12, was the aunt of Barnabas. So her son John Mark and Barnabas were cousins. Got to connect it for you. John Mark wrote the Gospel of John. James, in verse 17, is the oldest of the Lord's half-brothers. All right. And he was the leader of the Jewish church, the one that was beheaded. Acts gives us then a really good framework in any situation, any leadership paradigm, as to what you need to be doing, how you need to be doing it, and perhaps even with whom you need to be doing it. Nothing is known about the reason for Herod's hatred, except the fact that perhaps people were giving other people glory that he felt should be coming to him. But here's the thing. Here's the problem. The problem is ego drove King Herod of Saul's day, just as it had driven his father and grandfather. They all desperately lack character. Herod was the surname of the family father. A lot of people don't understand that. Herod is the family's name. Herod is my family's name. So my son Andrew, Jason, Aaron, Jalen, that's their first name. But Herod is the family name. Herod is the family name. And so very often, sometimes we confuse the different Herods, but they all pretty much acted the same, as we see in our text. They all desperately lacked character. Herod was just completely messed up. And so he held power by the Roman government. Herod the Great ruled at the time of Jesus' birth. He was the one who killed all the male babies in Jerusalem. Herod Antipas ordered the beheading of John the Baptist. And so we find this Herod here in Acts, pretty much acting almost really the same way. So look at this. He mistreated his own citizens, verse 1. He unjustly ordered the arrest of Jewish believers in order to harass them. Lesson 2, we find he executed innocent people in verse 2. He had James killed. There was no reason why he killed James, but he had him executed. Lesson 3, he made decisions based on popularity. And some of that's happening right now, but don't want to go down that path. When he saw it pleased the Jews to kill James, He had Peter arrested too. There was no reason why he should have done either, but it was because of popularity. And so I say to you, leaders, be careful how you make decisions based upon popularity as opposed to making decisions based upon principle, especially God's principles. Lesson 4, he acted irrationally in different times. He killed the 16 guards. I mean, just think about it. Because these 16 guards, the four sets of guards that we talked about, he went back and he took all 16 guards and he had all of them executed. You see that in verse 19. And of course, you know, he harbored anger towards others. You see that in verse 20. You also see in verse 20 where he sought power, all right, out of insecurity. Be careful how you try to go after power, especially when it doesn't belong to you. In fact, what I would share with you is, you know, I often share with my staff, never, never allow your ambitions to take you where neither your capabilities nor your integrity can sustain you, all right? Don't try to do things just for the sake of doing things, all right? He projected an image that really wasn't his. And then, of course, in verse 23, you know, he was blinded by his ego. All right. And so the problem, simply put, was ego. As you break out of this, as you move from now being penned up over these past 18 months, and for some people even longer, and you decide to break out of your walls to do things that God has called you to do, be careful that you don't let it become about you. All right. I often talk about with my staff the four agreements and understanding if you're about transformation, not transaction, transformation. You've got to make sure that those agreements are in alignment. And that simply means, by Ruiz, he wrote the book on the four agreements, Manuel. He says, be impeccable with your word. As you break out of your walls, be impeccable with your word. Agreement number 2, don't take anything personal. The moment you decide, brothers and sisters, to take something personal, you're making it about you. It's not about you. It's about the mission. It's about the goal. It's about the organization. It's about the ministry. Don't make it personal. Agreement number 3, don't make assumptions. People who make assumptions lack the courage to ask the hard questions. Ask those hard questions. And then, of course, lastly, always do your best. Let me hasten to my last point. Prescribe the prescription. The breakout that Peter experienced was not normal. He didn't just, you know, back in the old Westerns where people want to break you out of jail, they'll come and blow a hole and you walk out, or some of the other more sophisticated ways. But no. This breakout was not by man. This breakout was by a divine. I mean, when you look at the story, you begin to, you know, the angel speaks, the chains fall off. He moves to the door and it opens. Every single thing about this breakout story is about God being in charge. And so what I want to say to you is that you've got to be really careful that you don't confuse God's biddings with you running ahead of God. Don't run ahead of God as you break out of your walls. All right. Herod was all messed up. And so how do you avoid the traps as you break out? To improve his character and build a solid foundation for your own leadership, there's some things you must do. Number 1, you've got to search for the cracks. Being sidelined for 18 months or 2 years, nothing will be the same on the other side of COVID-19. Nothing. I don't care what organization you're running, nothing will be the same. Churches will not be the same. And so you've got to search for the cracks. You've got to look at the major areas of your life. Identify where you're weak, or have taken some shortcuts in the past as you're looking to retool how you're going to lead after a breakout. Number two, look for patterns. All right. Do any weakness remains as you're now looking to break out to do something new, something fresh, something exciting? Look for patterns. Patterns can help you diagnose character flaws. Patterns can help you recognize what you need to be doing more of and what you need to be doing less of. Number three, face the music. Character repairs begin when you face your flaws and apologize to those you've wronged. I suspect over the past 18 months, while you've been penned up, hemmed up, shut up, that some things may have gone south. In the Army, we talk about people's first strategy. And really, everything we're doing is about people. Everything you should be doing is about people. And so basically, if there's some things that you've got to realign, just face the music. Face the music. If you've got to tell someone you're sorry, tell them you're sorry. All right. But face the music. And then, of course, lastly, you've got to stay teachable and rebuild. Once you face your past, create a plan to build towards the strength. And so in conclusion, if you're going to lead after a breakout, if you're going to be relevant after a breakout, and there's a difference between just doing things for the sake of doing things, but if you're going to be doing things because you want to be relevant, then you've got to do what I call my critical C's. You've got to connect with people. You've got to communicate the gospel or the good news in my tradition. And then you've got to correct the loss. But it starts with connecting with people. And if I had time, it's not my assignment right now, but if I had time, I would really dig into that some more, because I think more and more what we're not understanding is that everything we're doing as leaders is about people. And if we're not connecting with people, and if it means having to change some of our old modalities, millennials don't think the same way that Gen Xers think. They definitely don't think the same way that baby boomers or baby busters think, all right? But all of these, every person that you encounter, whether it's in a church or on your business, they process differently. They think differently. And so as you attempt to connect with them, you've got to try other strategies. And don't let anyone tell you, we've never done it like that before. Those words will kill your organization and will stunt your vision. But you've got to connect with people if you're going to lead after a breakout. You can't connect with them from a distance. If you have two plugs and you unplug, the light goes off. They've got to be touching. One writer says, in terms of how the beauty of what Jesus did, she says, Jesus went where the people were. He mingled with them. He won their confidence. And then he bid them follow me. And so it starts with going where people are. If it means going someplace that normally you might be uncomfortable, fine. But if you're serious about leading after a breakout, you cannot understand a person's tears if you're not willing to listen to their story. And listening to their story might mean hearing some things that might make you uncomfortable. But connect with people. All right. Communicate the gospel. Tell your story. Don't worry about all the things that people talk about that you say, I wish I could do this. I would. No, no. Don't worry about what you can't do. Worry about what you can do and tell that story. Tell people what God has done for you, what he's done for your family. Communicate the gospel, because that's all it is, good news. As one preacher, he's now gone on, by the name of E.E. Cleaver, used to always say, what is the gospel? He says, the gospel is one beggar telling another beggar where to find bread. Just think of it that way. We're all in the same boat, brothers and sisters. None of us are better than any of us. We're all in the same boat. We just might be in different seats at different parts. And then, of course, lastly, you've got to correct the loss. Don't One of the things that Herod did, and you saw it in the last part of the story, he took credit for something that he should not have taken credit for. There's so many different leadership lessons that I could address just from this story. But of course I can't. But what I will share with you, and John Maxwell talks about some of this in his leadership Bible, where he talks about what leaders do and what leaders don't do. See, leaders go where people are. Leaders first instill new values into the team. Leaders never misrepresent the product or the service. Leaders don't allow rejection to change the opinion of themselves. Don't allow other people's opinions of you to become your reality. Leaders don't do that. Fifthly, leaders know they have something that people need. You got to be convinced that what you have is of value and that people need what you have. Because if you're not convinced of that, then guess what? No one else will either. Leaders are motivated by love for people and a desire to serve. If you reach the point, brothers and sisters, where again it becomes about you, you have missed the point of leadership. It's not about you. It's always about people. And then lastly, leaders are on a mission and never drift from that mission. So as we begin to think about this week that we're going through, again, my task is just to set the preamble, just to set the table. As we're thinking about breaking out of our walls, whatever that wall might be, you've got to be clear that you're breaking out of the wall to do something. And as leaders, don't confuse leadership with management. And so leading after a breakout requires you to do something new, to do something distinctive, to do something refreshing, to do something valuable. And I believe with all my heart that if you are focused, that the devil's plan, the devil's platform becomes God's platform. And then at that point, you now have a place to start to perform God's plan and God's purpose for your life. Don't worry about what you don't understand. God will teach that to you. Don't worry about what we're going to do now that we're now getting ready to come out of COVID-19. Because remember, some other stuff is going to come at some point in time. The focus is that we've gone through this thing. We've been chained up. We've been hemmed up. We've been walled up. But it's time to break out. And so may God bless you as you continue to plan, as you begin to strategize, to not only learn after a breakout, listen after a breakout, but lead after a breakout. That is God's requirement for you and his expectation. May God bless you as we continue to worship him in the beauty of his holiness. God bless you.
Indeed, we can surely say that with God as our captain, we can never be in the wrong lane. Our hearts have been blessed. Our spiritual bodies have been made stronger. We have been fed with heavenly food, and we are full. Let's give God all the glory and all the honor and the praise while we lift up the speaker and the listeners in our prayers. Let me say special thanks to North Jamaica ASI chapter for having led out in this evening's activities, as well as all the other participants for the roles that you have played. I want to remind you that this is a week-long activity, and remember that Monday night you can't afford to be absent, where we have our National Business Forum. And so I invite you to join in Monday at 7 o'clock to be a part of this forum. You can't afford to miss it. And so I invite you now to just pause a little longer for the benediction. And so the Lord will bless you until we meet again. And you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory now and forever and for all eternity. Amen.
Wow. Yes. What a beautiful sermon that has been. I tell you, we truly want to thank you all for taking time out to be here with us this evening. And much thanks to none other than our presenter this evening, Dr. Andrew Harewood, who serves as a Deputy Chief of Chaplain for the United States Army. Doc, may the Lord continue to bless and keep you in all your endeavors. Truly, we've been blessed. Kamara.
Oh, yes, Alan, definitely. And I join you in expressing gratitude as well to the North Jamaica Conference, ASI Chapter, for being part of this vibrant event. We also want to thank you, our viewers, we couldn't have this without you at all. We thank you for tuning in. We thank all those who have come on board from the various platforms, NCU Radio, NCU TV. Blessed are those who watch.
Bless TV,
WCCN. And on top of that, we thank our technical support team here.
Here in West Jamaica Conference. That's right. Well, this is where we draw the curtains. But remember, we continue this 1 week of virtual celebration tomorrow evening.
Certainly.
And we start 7 o'clock Jamaica time. That's 7 p.m. Jamaica time. And please, we will be joining East Jamaica Conference.
Yes.
That's the East Jamaica ASI chapter.
And
we can't wait to go over there because it promises to be, what's my word?
Astronomical.
This is where we draw the curtains. And so on behalf of the entire technical team here at West Jamaica Conference, I'm Alan Green.
And I'm Kamara Dixon.
Saying stay connected.
Stay connected.